A little girl witnessed a bizarre scene. She saw a massive cruise ship heading straight for the shore. At first, her parents were calm, assuming the ship would stop on its own. However, like a steel beast, the cruise ship rapidly approached the shore. Seeing this, the family quickly got up and fled from the beach. At that moment, everyone on the beach realized the severity of the situation and started to frantically move sideways. Some recklessly got close with their phones to take photos. Fortunately, the giant ship eventually got stuck in the mud and sand, and no one was hurt. As they were evacuating, a nearby guard informed them that there had been several grounding incidents in recent days, all due to issues with the navigation systems. On their first day vacationing in the small town, they encountered such a bizarre incident. However, what nobody expected was that upon returning to the rented villa, Amanda discovered the computer couldn't connect to the internet. Suddenly, several moose appeared outside, which delighted the couple, as moose symbolized luck in American mythology. Without internet access, the family was extremely bored. The two children couldn't play on their phones and went to bed early. Only Amanda and her husband Clay were left playing with building blocks. Suddenly, there was a noise outside, in the secluded and unfamiliar vacation villa. A late night knock on the door made them very nervous. When Clay opened the door, he found a man and a woman standing there. Strangely, the man claimed to know Amanda, though she was completely baffled. The man introduced himself as George, the owner of the house. He said that Amanda had booked the house through email correspondence with him a few days ago. However, George and his daughter had gone to a nearby concert today, and since there was a power outage in their city center apartment, they decided to stay here for the night. They warmly invited themselves in, but Amanda was reluctant. She couldn't be sure if George's story was true. Even if the house was George's, it had already been rented to her family, and she didn't want their vacation interrupted. During the conversation, George mentioned that the city was in chaos, and they lived on the 80th floor, with the power out. Climbing back up to their apartment was not appealing. Amanda suggested the power outage might be temporary and could be resolved in a few hours, so she hoped George and his daughter could find another solution. Faced with such an awkward situation, the father and daughter found it difficult to explain further. So, George proposed he wanted to retrieve something from the cabinet, and the couple tacitly allowed his request. George took out a set of keys and adeptly opened a nearby cabinet, revealing his intention to take out $1,000 as compensation, hoping they would allow him and his daughter to stay overnight.
Clay,
upon seeing the $1,000, was immediately overjoyed and decided to let the father and daughter stay. However, Amanda remained uneasy and requested a private talk with Clay. Clay argued that since they had the keys to the room, they must be the owners of the house. But Amanda countered that professional thieves could have master keys, and opening a cabinet was not a difficult task. After a heated discussion, Clay decided to verify the situation again. If there was still anything suspicious, he would then ask them to leave. To their surprise, upon leaving the room, they found George had prepared cocktails for them. Clay took a sip and was immediately full of praise for George's skill. However, Amanda not only refused to drink, but also asked cautiously what was in the drink and even requested to see George's ID. George searched himself and realized his wallet was not on him, quickly explaining it might be in his coat pocket. Suddenly, a jarring noise from the TV caught their attention, and they turned to look. The situation was not as simple as they thought. Not only was there a power outage in the city, but also an internet blackout. Under such chaotic circumstances, refusing to let the father and daughter stay would be inhumane. Reluctantly, Amanda compromised, and the pair were arranged to stay in the basement for the night. George's daughter, Ruth, was speechless, complaining to her father that despite it being their own home, they now had to stay in the basement. That night, while everyone was sound asleep, an emergency news broadcast suddenly played on the TV, announcing that the entire United States was undergoing a cyber attack. Early the next morning, Amanda's younger daughter, Rosie, suddenly woke her up, eager to watch the finale of Friends, but lamenting the lack of internet. Amanda assured her that the internet would be back soon and asked her to be patient. Just after getting up, Amanda saw several breaking news alerts on her phone about their country currently being under cyber attack. However, when she went to wake Clay, those messages had mysteriously disappeared. Meanwhile, Rosie, in the yard, noticed several moose wandering nearby. Curiously, she walked towards them, unaware that the entire forest was actually teeming with an unusual gathering of moose. After waking up, George decided to check on a nearby friend's house, hoping to gather some information about the ongoing situation. However, upon arrival, he found the house empty. Inside, he discovered a satellite phone, a device capable of making calls even when cell signals are unavailable. Unfortunately, after several attempts, George found that the satellite phone had no signal either. Meanwhile, Clay drove into town to see what was happening, but without navigation, he could only wander aimlessly. Suddenly, he encountered a Spanish-speaking woman by the road, who seemed to be in some kind of urgent situation. Unable to understand her, Clay had no choice but to drive away,
feeling an ominous sense of foreboding.
At that moment, he witnessed a terrifying scene. A huge drone appeared in the sky, rapidly approaching his direction and apparently spraying something red. Frightened, Clay turned around and fled as red cards, resembling red envelopes, fell from the sky like a blanket. Clay's fear might seem irrational. Was he afraid the cards would scratch his car? Yet, in the context of the bizarre and chaotic events unfolding around them, his reaction reflects a deeper fear of the unknown and potentially dangerous situation. On the other side, George arrived at a beach where he accidentally noticed a watch on the ground. Curious, he bent down to pick it up, only to discover it was attached to a dead arm, which terrified him. Turning around, he realized the entire beach was in disarray, littered with bodies and airplane wreckage. While George was still trying to make sense of the situation, he saw an airplane rapidly approaching him. With the plane seemingly about to crash into him, George took off running. Quickly returning home, George relayed the bizarre occurrences he encountered to Amanda. He started with the satellite phone that had no signal, then the plane crashing towards the shore, and the beach littered with airplane wreckage and bodies. George initially thought this incident was similar to a cyber attack a few years ago in the Philippines that only caused partial computer control and network paralysis. However, the severity of this event was unprecedented to them. While they were talking, a piercing noise suddenly came from outside, but fortunately, it stopped after half a minute. The two children also returned inside unharmed, leaving no one able to explain exactly what was happening. At that moment, Clay finally came back safely, holding a red card with Arabic writing on it. Amanda's son immediately recognized the pattern on the card. Realizing it was unsafe to stay any longer, Amanda and her husband decided to take their children to her sister's house in New Jersey for a temporary stay. Despite George's strong advice against taking the risk of driving, they chose to leave the area. However, while on their way, they encountered a severe traffic accident. Amanda, puzzled, got out of the car to investigate and was shocked to see countless Teslas in a chain collision on the road ahead, eerily without any drivers in them. When she noticed the displays indicating the autopilot feature, she immediately realized the gravity of the situation. Sure enough, another Tesla was rapidly approaching from a distance. Amanda quickly yelled for her husband to get back in the car. After the accident, the family had no choice but to return to George's villa, finding themselves with nowhere else to turn and waiting quietly for any news.
That night,
a flock of flamingos unexpectedly arrived in the pool outside, a sight none of them understood the significance of. Both families spent a restless night filled with worry, except for little Rosie, who was preoccupied with the thought of possibly never seeing the finale of Friends. The next morning, Amanda's son woke up feeling discomfort in his teeth. To his shock, a gentle tug caused one to fall out, followed by several more. This terrified the family. George speculated that the boy might have contracted some strange disease or been exposed to radiation, but with no hospitals nearby and the highways out of the city blocked, their options were limited. The only potential source of help was a friend of George's who had stocked up on supplies a few days earlier, seemingly in the know about some insider information. As George and Clay were preparing to take the boy to this friend for help, Amanda discovered that her daughter Rosie had disappeared without a trace early in the morning. At this point, Amanda's son suddenly vomited blood, prompting George and Clay to rush him to their friend's house for help. However, upon their arrival, not only did the friend refuse them entry, but he also brandished a shotgun, demanding they leave immediately. This stark reaction shocked George, who couldn't believe that a decades-long friendship could end so callously. George explained they were only seeking medicine for the child, but his friend insisted on prioritizing his own family's safety over outsiders. The friend speculated that the noise might be due to Cuba's involvement, suggesting they had developed a microwave weapon that emits radiation through sound waves, causing people's teeth to fall out. He mentioned that Russia had recently recalled its staff from Washington, implying that whatever was happening outside could be very serious, potentially even leading to war. Faced with his friend's ruthless stance, George was desperate. Clay, trying to explain his son's condition, offered the $1,000 in hopes of getting some medicine. But the friend dismissed the offer, saying money was as worthless as waste paper now and then forced them to leave. Driven to desperation, George drew his handgun in a standoff with his friend, neither side willing to back down. Clay hurriedly intervened to prevent any rash actions, then, heartbroken, shared their family's plight, his son's teeth falling out, his daughter's disappearance, and their simple wish to get medicine for their child. Moved by Clay's words, the man was eventually touched and accepted the $1,000, handing over some of his stockpiled anti-radiation medication. As they were preparing to leave, George finally revealed the reason for his sudden arrival at the villa. He had also received insider information about an impending, unspecified disaster. George had a friend who was a contractor, reportedly involved in a major tiling project at the Pentagon, who had leaked information to him. The initial phase of the attack involved cutting off the internet and electricity to sever communication and transportation, instilling panic among the populace. The next steps were to render the targeted population deaf and paralyzed, using secret attacks and misinformation to scare them, breaking down their ability to defend themselves, and ultimately, driving people to turn on each other. These simple three stages were designed to dismantle America. Hearing all this, Clay was left looking ashen-faced. While Amanda and Ruth were setting out to search for Rosie, they were shocked to see a mushroom cloud rising over the city skyline in the distance. The sight left them stunned,
realizing their city had been subjected to a nuclear strike.
Meanwhile, Rosie had already made her way into a luxurious mansion. There, she first found some food and ate voraciously. Then, she discovered a basement that turned out to be a fallout shelter, equipped not only with exercise equipment, but also with various living necessities. The shelves were filled with an array of ornaments, and a computer in the corner could receive important news updates. What delighted Rosie the most was the presence of a large TV and a bookshelf stocked with enough TV series to last her 10 years, including the much-anticipated finale of Friends. Eagerly, she couldn't wait to watch the finale she had been looking forward to.